You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Dr. Teodros Avery. I'm the professor of jazz studies here at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. And today is the fifth session of a class entitled Key Movements, the Age of Jazz. Today I'll be talking about several different eras from the 1920s, one of which will be the film called A Song is Born. It was a very important film introducing jazz to the masses of society. We're going to talk about Paul Whiteman, Fletcher Henderson, George Gershwin, and others. We're going to listen to lots of jazz today. And the reason why we're going to talk about the politics, sociology, psychology, and just the general thought in American society during this time. And what we're gonna do is play the music right after that so you get a real idea of what was going on in society as the music was being developed. And what you'll find is that the music was a breakaway from how society was prior to that moment or that decade, the 1920s. So what I'm hoping you'll understand is that jazz was a breakaway. Not only jazz, but there were some other things as well, but they were breaking away from old traditions and they had a new style of music that was emerging. So that's what we want to really understand during this session. First, we're going to talk about the intellectual context of the 1920s. Now, the rejection of tradition and the celebration of the new was a pervasive cultural theme that historians have identified as a tension between progress and tension as a central paradox in American history and culture. So you've got this rub going on. You have the traditionalists, they're saying this is how society is, this is how, you know, religion affects us as a group of people and how we should conduct ourselves, and then you have the new people, the intellectuals, the entertainers, even businessmen and women who were pushing against the old way of life. So this is a rub that's happening, you know, a rub. You know, there's some people who just don't see it the new way and some people from the new that don't see it the old way. They want to reject old ways of thinking. So the paradox is this: how can we carry on the tradition of the past while also celebrating the changes that were taking place in the society? Now we're gonna look at a person by the name of Ezra Pound. He was a poet. Here he is right here in his later years. He was born in Idaho in 1885, right after World War I. In his poem, Hugh Selwyn Mauberly, he expressed what many had felt, and that was a collapse of ideals and trust in democracy that rocked intellectual discourse for the decade. Writing of soldiers who had walked eye deep in hell, believing in old men's lies, then unbelieving, came home to a life, home to many deceits. That's his quote. I'll read that again. Quote, walked eye deep in hell, believing in old men's lies, then unbelieving, came home to a life, home to many deceits. And what that means is that these soldiers had came back from war, World War I, and they were totally just disillusioned with what they had been through. They felt like they had fought for people who maybe didn't see the real deal on the ground. So they came back disillusioned, a lot of people from that time. Not everybody, but a lot of people. And so you had a group of people who just felt like, man, you know, we just fought this war and, you know, it wasn't for what we thought it was going to be for. It was for something else. And not only that, you come back, you see that a lot of people are not living out of poverty, that there are a lot of people living in poverty, and then you see a whole group of people becoming very, very wealthy as a result of the war, and we'll talk about that later. Go to this next picture, and you'll understand. Here it says, someone talked over there, and that's, you know, extreme sarcasm to the mood in society where no one could really talk about anything. And ironically, the battle for world democracy had left Americans without their basic individual freedoms. During this time, laws such as the Espionage Act of 1917 and the Sedition Act of 1918 prevented open criticism of or opposition to the political establishment or to any war efforts by the U.S. government. Let's go to the next photo. And you see on the front page of the newspaper, there are people who are being raided on by you know, government officials, being accused of, you know, not being American. And so this was not a good time. There was a crackdown also on labor leaders, socialists, anarchists, communists, and people who were accused of being communists. Now, the problem was that many people were accused of being communists and they were not. And so it was a very oppressive time in the country where people could not fully express themselves and they could not talk about what was going on in the government. They could not talk about what was going on in society openly if it did not agree with government. So out of that, you have people who want to break away from that, whether that is in art, music, you know, the poetry, even in psychoanalysis, where people wanted to talk more about their feelings because they were being held down by these different laws and also axioms that have been, you know, passed down through generations about how to behave and how to conduct yourself in society. We'll go to the next photo. Even though the rest of the country was experiencing an economic downturn, 42,000 new millionaires emerged from wartime business profits. This exacerbated the tension between the classes and resentment among the working class. So you see in the picture right there, you have the Haves on the left. They've got nice big buildings. And then on the right side, you have the have-nots. The buildings are smaller. Now you have to remember, 42,000 new millionaires during the 19-teens into the 20s. That's a lot of money. 42,000 new millionaires. This is when, you know, you could go to a movie for like 5 cents. So I'm just trying to give you some context for how the tension was building, that you had people making lots of money off of war, and then you had people who were fighting the war and coming back, and they were disillusioned. So it gives you an idea of how frustrated people were. And this is important for you to understand, because during this time is when all this great music came about, when these poets started, you know, writing, when the Harlem Renaissance started happening, when the flappers emerged, when women's rights, women's suffrage movement, when the women's suffrage movement happened. All of this is happening during this time when there's this shift, this social shift, and that's very important to understand. And I'm saying that very clearly for people who are wondering, you know, what should I be listening for? So I'm trying to show you or explain to you what you should be listening for, what you should be zeroing in on. Okay, we're going to go to the next photo. Between 1920 and 1922, with the election of Warren G. Harding, the rise of business culture with its emphasis on materialism and anti-intellectualism, and later corruption, ushered in an intellectual and artists who were completely detached from politics. So you had a lot of people watching as business people gained so much power economically and chose not to be intellectual, didn't really care about different events going on in the world as it related to how those things affected people and how they thought and how they lived. They were unconcerned about that they were just really focused on making money. And then you saw the emergence of corrupt business practices during this time. There's starting to be a divide between these groups of people. Moneymakers, business culture, ascending, not caring about the intellectuals, the people, the common man and woman, the middle class and the lower class. So you see this divide going on. Now, we also see the rise of machine culture. And here you're going to see a picture of a machine or machinery, or those are actually water heaters that were the product or the result of machinery. And what this is that water heaters were able to be sold and mass produced. And that was actually a great thing for the average American, because now you could be at home and have running hot water, which today we take for granted. But once upon a time, that you had to heat the water up in a pot and then pour that water into a bucket. So it was not really, you could not just have hot water. That was not readily available to the people. And then here we see in the next photo, we see a room full of women sewing fabrics. And what this led to was the ability for someone to go into a store and just buy a shirt that was already made and sitting on the rack or on the shelf. You didn't necessarily have to have custom clothes made, which was more of the norm. You get a suit made or something like that. So all these women are sewing fabrics, and then the clothes will be ready for people to go to buy and to wear immediately. And then in the next photo we have Victor talking machines. Oh, that's a sewing machine. There we go, Victor talking machines. These are early record players being sold. So that's that right there in that picture. That's the equivalent of going into a stereo entertainment store like Best Buy, one of those stores. And you go in and everything's already made and it's been manufactured with a machine and it's just waiting for you to go buy it. We're seeing the emergence of all these machines that can now be bought. Entertainment centers, clothing that's manufactured and waiting to be bought. Then you have people who are working those machines. And so employment starts to pick up. Now we're going to see in the next photo, we're going to be at a car showroom and you're going to see Model T Fords waiting to be sold. And so people can walk in just like today and they can look at a car and say, hey man, I like that car, I want to buy it. Get financing and walk out the door with a car. You don't have to ride around with a horse and buggy anymore, which was normal. People had to ride with horses and buggies. Now, because of machine culture, they can actually just get a car and leave the showroom and have transportation to go to work or to travel to other cities, anything like that. And so you don't have to rely on a horse anymore. And I know that might be a little funny to some people, but that was a major, major accomplishment and change in terms of how people lived their lives. In terms of the music, you could get in that car and you could go to a gig. You could ride in a car to a gig, and then you could ride to another city and drive to another city and drive to another city. So now all of a sudden you have a tour set up. And you had more freedom in how you traveled. You did not have to be on a train
where you had to leave at a certain time and then you just wait until you get to the next city. With a car, you can make individual stops, maybe even get more gigs because you can play in more venues between two major cities. So that's something that affected the musicians immediately. Okay, now we're going to watch this short documentary on the rise of the Ford plant in Detroit. This is a perfect example of how machinery transformed America in the development of cars, Ford cars. Okay, so here we go.
Henry Ford had once been voted the greatest man in history, after Napoleon Bonaparte and Jesus Christ. Perhaps Americans saw in him what they liked best in themselves in 1927. A millionaire Huck Finn, a shy, awkward farm boy turned automaker, who hated laziness and disorder, labor unions, and Wall Street bankers. A prankster. He was the living symbol of power, prosperity, and America's faith in every man for himself, in that time before the Great Depression, when captains of industry mattered more than presidents. Back in 1914, Ford had revolutionized assembly line production, and to keep his workers from quitting, he announced he would raise their pay to a generous $5 a day, twice what they earned before, and twice what they could earn at any other auto company. It was a simple American bargain. Security and high wages in exchange for hard work.
The legend of Henry Ford, of course, was greatly embellished by his offer of $5 a day, and the word of that penetrated the most remote mountain village in West Virginia and Kentucky and Tennessee, and well, the Russo brothers heard about the $5 a day and Wheeling, too, and I can tell you, it looked mighty good.
They came to Detroit in hopes of a life they could find nowhere else. Ford workers enjoyed company picnics, could live in company housing, and even buy the Ford cars they produced. High wages paid off in high production and high profits for the company.
My family moved to Detroit in 1927 from Columbus, Ohio. I didn't like Detroit when I first moved. In fact, I ran away three times, went back to Columbus, Ohio. But my daddy finally convinced me the third time that I had to stay. And Detroit at that time was a booming town. Businesses were booming, cars were being bought, and you had the big bands, you had the dance halls. Everything was going great.
My father and uncle arrived in Detroit in 1926 from Mexico via Kansas City in a Model T. People came from Guanajuato, San Luis Potosí, of course, Mexico City.
And in our neighborhood, I know of no kid that I associate with where their parents were born in America. Nobody.
We had the Poles. We had the Lithuanians, we had Finnish, we had Scotch, we had Italian.
In great waves of migration from Europe and the American South, the hopeful had found their way to Detroit's thriving ethnic neighborhoods. They had been Ukrainian peasants and Alabama sharecroppers. Now they were auto workers, 50,000 strong at Ford's River Rouge factory, the largest industrial complex in history. Here was a strange new world, thundering forges, the huge foundry and powerhouse, the endless miles of assembly line. They called it the Cathedral of Industry, and here, like clockwork, they made four cars every minute, 240 an hour, 6,000 Fords a day. The heart of American industry was Detroit, and the heart of Detroit was Henry Ford's Rouge.
So there we go. That was the Ford car plant in Detroit. They spoke of Henry Ford. He is the man who is responsible for the Ford cars that we see today. Henry Ford was born in 1863 in Greenfield, Michigan. He is the founder of Ford Automobiles. He was considered to be the chief of American industry and one of the greatest businessmen America has ever produced. To give you perspective on how successful Henry Ford was at producing cars, listen to this. In 1900, there were 8,000 automobiles in the United States. By 1926, there were 20 million. That's 6 years, okay? Went from 8,000 to 20 million. And that's because he was able to mass produce these cars with that heavy machinery. So we're talking about machinery and how it changed how people in America were able to live. By 1920, half of the cars in the world were Model T Fords, were his cars in the world. So he was outperforming everybody, Mercedes, BMW. They may not have had BMWs, but I believe they had Mercedes back then. But anybody who was dealing with transportation, in terms of individual transportation, he was the leader in that lane. So this is to give you an idea of how powerful American business had become during that time. Things had changed drastically during this time, during this decade, and that's what we're focusing on. Next person we're going to look at is Antonio Gramsci. Okay, now this person right here is probably the opposite of Henry Ford, okay, in his aesthetic, in his beliefs. Antonio Gramsci was born in 1891 in Sardinia, Italy. He was an Italian political theorist and an activist. Antonio Gramsci saw Henry Ford's system of mass production and over-concern for his workers' leisure time as being part of an American problem, and that this type of business thinking went hand in hand with the emergence of a culture of increased social control, mechanization, and conformity. So this is important to really check out, that you have this emergence of really strong figures like Henry Ford, but someone like Antonio felt like they were overreaching. They wanted to know what workers were doing when they were home, when they were celebrating on the weekends, when they were with their families. He felt that was a little too invasive. They had too much control, too much hands-on influence over the future of these people who worked for their companies. On the other hand, someone like Henry Ford wanted to maximize his results as a business person. And with that in mind, he only hired people who did not live lives that would not produce the best results. Now, he was able to produce 20 million, went from 8,000 to 20 million cars. He was able to do that because he was so finite in how he produced his business and how he ran his business. So there's an argument on both sides. Had he not been so involved in choosing certain types of people to work for his company, that he would not have been that successful, going from 8,000 to 20 million cars in 6 years, and then eventually being responsible for half of the automobiles in the world. Let me tell you why. Because without a certain type of worker, he would not have been able to have that person produce, say, I don't know the number right offhand, but say 20 cars a day. To be on that line of that manufacturing machine and be able to work fast and focused and have all these people working very fast and focused to produce all these cars. Maybe you have somebody who comes in, he had a hangover over the weekend, he's just not gonna perform as fast as someone who doesn't drink and party. So that's where they were coming from. But like I said, Antonio Gramsci did not see it that way. He felt like they were overreaching. And that this led to conformity, and that means, you know, making sure that everybody behaves a certain way and fits into a certain slot. And if they do not fit into that, that they are an outcast, that they would be accused of being an outlier, you know, somebody who did not want to conform. So there's a fair argument on both sides. But that's what I want you to understand, is that you had Henry Ford over here, and then you had other people who were criticizing that type of thinking, people like Antonio Gramsci. You need to know that not everybody was pro-American business, and not everybody was anti-business either, that there was a divide. Next, we're going to move on to the philosopher John Dewey. Here he is right here. John Dewey was born in 1859 in Burlington, Vermont. He was an American philosopher, psychologist, educational reformer. He believed that overthrowing the past was a political act of reviving democracy. He argued for social stability based not on tradition, but on intelligent and rational responses to the needs of social progress in the present. He argued for social stability based not on tradition, but on being intelligent and being rational. So that's important to think like that. I mean, I would agree with him that you need to be intelligent, you need to be rational,
but not everyone believed that. And as I said earlier, many people were emerging to make a lot of money, and they definitely didn't believe that. And so that's why I said it was a divide between these different groups.
All right, next we're going to move on to Robert S. Brookings. Here he is here, and he's responsible for the Brookings Institute. Other areas of cultural change in America included social science research. And that's basically saying that, you know, let's study this group of people and see what they tend to do, what they tend to like, dislike, spend their money on, you know, where do they eventually go to? What do they eventually end up doing?
And then having results, and then at that point, people will listen to these groups, such as the Brookings Institute, and they'll say, well, let's ask the Brookings Institute what they think about this group of people over here, or those people who migrated over to this area, you know, things like that. So that information, that data became important to other people who were policymakers, and they would look to the Brookings Institute as an authority. So that's Robert S. Brookings.
Next, we have Madison Grant. Madison Grant was born in 1865 in New York. He was a lawyer, but he is most known for his book, The Passing of the Great Race. So this is a book that was really dealing with preserving the Caucasian race during this time. And they felt that other groups were a threat to them. He thought that other groups were a threat. And so he wrote this book, and it became very popular and was also mentioned in The Great Gatsby. That was a reference that was made. And so it was looked at as being a book that was trusted, that the information in it was trusted, and that they could look to it and believe in it, you know, whether we agree with it or not, it is what it is. But that was an important book during the time. Next, we have Ellsworth Huntington. Ellsworth Huntington was born in 1876 in Galesburg, Illinois. He's in the top right there with the glasses on, the bald guy. He was a geographer and the former president of the Eugenics Society. And the Eugenics Society was basically a society that made generalizations about different groups of people and their potential intelligence.
And the information that they came up with and the resolutions that they came up with were used to write policies about different groups of people. The one thing that is not good is that it was not based on, it wasn't always based on science, that a lot of times it was based on theories, just theories that they wrote and came up with. So this, the Eugenic Society is responsible for a lot of the limitations that were placed on people that did not fit into that slot that they wanted to exist throughout the country. So you had black people who were not deemed as being intelligent to these men, and there were generalizations that they came up with, and then those generalizations were used to pass laws that limited black people, other people, women, from going up in society. Eugenics. That's an area you should know, and it will come back up later. So eugenics. Now, next we're going to look at T. Lothrop Stoddard. He's in the photo as well. He was born in 1883 in Brookline, Massachusetts. He was a historian, journalist, eugenicist, and a Klansman, Ku Klux Klansman. Okay? He's most famous for his book, The Rising Tide of Color. So these are the beginnings of what we now know as being race theory, that this group of people is this, that group of people is that. They're only going to go this far in their intelligence. They're only going to go this far in their pursuit of education. They, you know, generalizations, real generalizations that were being written about, and like I said, used to make public policy laws based on these theories that these guys came up with. Charlie Henry Pearson was born in 1830. He's the other fellow right there. He was a British-born Australian historian, educationist, politician, and a journalist. So these men are the men who are saying basically everyone else is not smart, limited in their intelligence, prone to certain types of behavior, right? And that was the, they developed a legal premise for legal racism through their theories and what they wrote. So that when the other people who were breaking away, people like the women during the women's suffrage movement, African Americans and early civil rights, leaving the Jim Crow South, immigrants from Europe, because you have to know that during this time, there were immigrant groups like Italians. They weren't respected. They weren't respected and accepted. You know, Irish people, they didn't fit into these men's theories about intelligence, about what being American was. They had a very finite theory on that, and it did not include blacks, women, immigrants from certain European countries. They just didn't see them as being equal. So you had these other people pushing against that, trying to break away from that. And jazz music was a part of that breakaway.
Next, we have Sigmund Freud. Sigmund Freud, you'll see his picture in a minute. Sigmund Freud was born in 1856 in the Czech Republic. he created psychoanalysis. And psychoanalysis is basically a dialogue between a patient and a doctor, that there was a give and take. You know, if anyone has ever had therapy, you know, you talk about your problems. Not that I ever have, but in a therapy situation, a person would speak to their therapist, and the therapist would speak back to them, and then they would come up with different. They would have clarity on what that person was dealing with, what kind of life they were living, what problems they were having. And there was this back and forth, and that was a new thing. Today, psychoanalysis is common. Not everyone, but
a lot of people participate in that. But back then, no, you didn't participate. You just kept your mouth shut, held it in, and then it will come out in other ways, like, you know, drinking or this or that or whatever. Sigmund Freud offered an alternative that is a standard today, but at that time it was new. And that's important. That's very important in American society today, and also it's important because it marks a change in how people were able to express themselves about their problems or about their challenges. And also the fact that someone like Sigmund Freud was interested in speaking to their patient about it. You remember, or maybe you don't know this, once upon a time, people who were considered different oftentimes, you know, would be locked away in a crazy house. Maybe they weren't crazy. Maybe they just wanted to express themselves in a different way. But during this time, you know, you were crazy. They write you up, and you were crazy. And we saw when we were studying the women's suffrage movement that there were situations where women were speaking up for themselves about being oppressed, and a doctor could write a report and just have them sent away to a nut house. That's what they called it back then. But they would send them to a nut house and they'd be gone. There was no speaking up about what was going on with you. Sigmund Freud, people like him, they were the change in that area, that a patient could speak up about what was going on and there would be communion between the two. And they could figure out what was going on, what was the problem, what could it be fixed. Maybe, and I'm sure, a lot of people were sent off to crazy houses, but they just needed to express themselves. So this time during the 1920s, this is when things changed in that area. Very important, because it shaped not only the years after, during the 20s and after, but today you can see anybody can, even here on college campus, go to see a
therapist. That's because of Sigmund Freud. Now, at this time, also, there was religion against science, or the state of Tennessee versus John Thomas Scopes. And when I say religion versus science, you have to understand that America was a very conservative
religious society for the most part, and they did not invite scientific theories into the public discussion about man, what man came from, etc.
So the state of Tennessee versus John Thomas Scopes, it was a trial on whether modern science should be taught in schools. So you have the religious people who say Adam and Eve, right?
And humanity was born out of Adam and Eve. And then you have the scientists that say humans were born out of primates or apes, and that the ape eventually evolved into human beings. So
this teacher, John Thomas Scopes, introduced the idea of
apes being the originators of human beings, and he was challenged. That, hey, you can't talk about that here. This is a religious, you know, society. This is a religious town. You know, We don't want that here. And so there were debates, there was a trial, and the conversation came up. Today, people accept that science can be an option in describing humanity and its beginnings. But back then, that was a no-no. No one wanted to see or even hear about that. It was not accepted at all. So this trial was a turning point in society.
Now we're going to move on to some musical figures. Now I want you to understand that during the time of all this, you had people in music that were creating and starting to write and becoming popular and becoming
household names. One of those people was Paul Whiteman. You see him here in the photo. He was known as Pops,
which is interesting because Louis Armstrong was known as Pops too. But I guess Pops is like Mom's Pops. You know, everybody had a little, you know, a little nickname that was related to mother and father, you know. So that's all good. Paul Whiteman was born in 1890 in Denver, Colorado. He was born into a musical family, learning the viola instead of the violin, as his father encouraged. Not necessarily a jazz musician, but more a person who was influenced by jazz. He became very, very, very successful, and successful as a band leader. He was able to, I mean, you want to talk about Henry Ford and how he developed the car and how successful he was at that. Paul Whiteman could be considered the same type of business mind in how he mass-produced music for the audiences that he performed for. And he was successful in music in the same way that Henry Ford was successful with cars. Same type of mind. And he was invited to present his music all over the United States. So we're going to listen to a song by Paul Whiteman and his orchestra. This song is called Whispering. What I want you to understand is this. This is not hardcore jazz. This is more the meetings of jazz, popular music, and classical music. Those worlds came together. He was able to reach a lot of people because of the classical music and light dance music that he provided in his arrangements and in his music.
And that had a lot to do with his music being very popular, but it is not really jazz, as you know, as we will listen to and also as we have heard already. It is influenced by jazz.
But what he did do, and he was smart for doing this, was that he brought in players who were really jazz musicians. So he brought in Big Spider Beck. He brought in Frankie Trumbauer. Those were jazz musicians. So he was smart in that he knew his strengths and his weaknesses, and he also knew that he needed pieces within his orchestra to really make it shine and also to attract people who were into jazz, but maybe they weren't hardcore jazz listeners, but maybe they were coming from classical music, or maybe they liked marching band music, or maybe they just liked to dance in a very light manner, but wanted to hear something different.
That being the jazz element.
So know that about Paul Whiteman. Great, great band leader, great arranger, orchestrator.
Not really a jazz musician, but it is what it is. He knew what he was doing and how he brought the pieces together.
So we're going to listen to Paul Whiteman and his orchestra. This is Whispering. Thank you. right, so, you know, nice two feel, you know. Easy to dance to. Dunt, 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 dunt. Not really the type of song that has a lot of polyrhythms or syncopation.
So just a nice two fill and people can just dance to it. That's very important for you to understand that
there was a dance music element to it that was simple.
That was easy for people to get into. And that had a lot to do with his success. That he knew the audience he was playing to. He knew not to get too jazzy. He was not really a jazz musician, so he wouldn't really go in that direction. But he also wanted to make it jazzy a little bit so that he could attract people to a sound that had elements of a real new sound, okay?
We're gonna listen to Paul Whiteman's orchestra once again. This song is called Hot Lips. So that was Paul Whiteman, Hot Lips.
And now we're going to listen to another song by him and his orchestra. This is called Linger a While. Thank you.
now you have the sound of Paul Whiteman's orchestra in your ear, hopefully. You understand, at least by hearing, what his sound was about. Now we're going to go to another person from this time. His name is Fletcher Henderson. There he is sitting at the piano. Fletcher Henderson was born in 1897 in Cuthbert, Georgia, known as Smack because he dressed so well. Check that out, Smack.
What does that mean, Smack? Like smack, you know, you see him walk in a room, smack, maybe he smacked you upside your head with his cool fashions, you know?
Smack. He originally moved to New York to study chemistry in graduate school, but found that jobs were closed to him because he was black. He started working for W.C. Handy's publishing company as a song plugger. Then he backed Ethel Waters before being asked to join Benny Goodman's orchestra. So here's somebody who was really a scientist or chemistry major, but he could not work because he was black. Now, I want to explain to you some connectors so you understand why
we're talking about all of these people.
He was not able to find a job. Those jobs in science were closed to him because he was black.
That is directly related to the four gentlemen who were eugenicists. It was commonly thought that blacks were not intelligent enough to go into science. So I wanted to make these connections for you and to explain to you why you had such an influx of black
artists
and jazz musicians and why that music became so influential around the world. Because not only did you have intelligent or talented musicians, you had very intelligent human beings who put that kind of scientific intelligence into their music. And so what you had was music that was really, really complex. When you listened to it, it was more than just a two beat. And Fletcher Henderson, when you listen to his arrangements, you can really hear the complexities of his scientific background in his music. It was very complex. So
that's important. I want you to understand that there were generalizations and axioms
passed down through society about certain groups of people and how intelligent they were or how unintelligent they were. And those men that I mentioned earlier, they were the types of people who could turn in books, paperwork, articles, and people would follow lead. And someone like Fletcher Henderson would not be able to work as a chemist. He wouldn't be accepted to get those kinds of jobs. So he went into music, and he ended up being extremely talented at it, and he also became the arranger for Benny Goodman. And if you know about music from this period, you know that Benny Goodman was one of the most successful artists of the 30s and 40s. All right, so where Fletcher Henderson could not express or rather work as a person in chemistry, he was able to express and work as someone in music. And that's important to know, because you want to know that these people were very, very intelligent, but they just were not given the opportunities.
Let's listen to Fletcher Henderson play Whitman Stomp. Fletcher Henderson and his orchestra.
They're going to pay homage to Paul Whiteman with, Whiteman Stomp. So this is homage to Paul Whiteman. Here we go. Thank you. There's a very complex approach to the music. And, you know, I tell you, as somebody that plays music, you can really hear when certain people are into studying different things like chemistry, physics, geometry, architecture. There's a certain way of thinking that they have, and they usually apply it to music, and it reflects that type of thinking. That's deeper science of music, not really for here, but just letting you know, as a professor who understands these things, he definitely was able to write music that reflected his scientific thinking. Trust me on that.
Now we're going to listen to Fletcher Henderson's orchestra play a song called My Gal, Sal. So I'm thinking that his gal or his girl was a woman named Sally, but he called her Sal. So My Gal, Sal. Here we go.
Thank you.
Still listening to Fletcher Henderson, and now we're going to listen to a song called Somebody Loves Me. Fletcher Henderson, Somebody Loves Me.
I wish I knew just who it could be. It worried me. Yes, ma'am. Everyone passed me by. I shout, hey, maybe. Maybe you were meant to be my loving baby. Baby, baby. Somebody loves me. And I wonder who. Baby, I don't know. Papa got to see tonight. Oh, my, my, my.
All right. Now we're going to move on to a gentleman by the name of George Gershwin. Okay. George Gershwin was born in 1898 in Brooklyn, New York. Within a few years, he became one of the most important musicians in popular music. George Gershwin was special because he understood classical music and he also understood and appreciated black music. So here's somebody who was able to take the blues and how influential it was and how it had its own style or its own sound. He was able to take elements of those sounds in the blues, the bending of notes. You know, like ba boom ba ba, ba boom ba ba, like that kind of sound. That's called a bend. If it wasn't a bend, it would go ba do da do, da do dee do. But the blues would take that, bend it, and say ba boom ba ba, ba boom ba. And Gershwin heard that and liked it and brought it and mixed it with classical music. And that was unique to the time, very unique. George Gershwin wrote music for Paul Whiteman as well. And one of those songs was a song by George Gershwin called Rhapsody in Blue, which he composed in 1924. So as I said, Paul Whiteman commissioned him to do so. And then
And then he went and wrote it. Commission means I'm paying you money to go write a song. So I'm going to pay you money. You go write it and come back, bring it to me, and then my ensemble is going to perform it. All right? Commissioned. So the solo, the piece is written for solo piano in the jazz band. But there's still elements, like I said, of classical music in the piece, and you'll hear that when you listen to it. And so we're going to listen to it right now, George Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. Let's listen to it. Probably his most well-known composition in terms of his arrangement, his arranging style. It's very big and grandiose. He has other songs too, but that's probably his most, you know, that's his big one, you know, that everyone knows. So think about how this music now, with someone like George Gershwin, who is taking styles from different cultures in America and he's mixing them together with European styles and coming up with his own sound, and how Fletcher Henderson, how he has a very swinging style, and at this time swinging was a black sound. It was a sound coming out of black America. And then you had Paul Whiteman, who was mixing a dance beat, a popular two-field type of dance beat, foxtrots, things like that. And he was mixing them with a couple of jazz musicians. So you had three different types of artists that were mixing styles. And you have to understand that this music at the time was, in the case of George Gershwin and Fletcher Henderson, was really going against what people thought about how certain groups should stay in their own lane and not mix with other groups. That this music was bringing people together, that it was an expression that people across all cultures could really identify with and felt like the changes that they wanted to see in society and also in themselves was happening in the music. That, you know, these people were writing music and playing these songs for people who wanted to see some change in society. So that's the great thing about jazz music, that it really was a way to bridge cultures in America and also the world.
Because jazz really became a world music.
Music that people of the world not only wanted to play, but also enjoyed, or rather enjoy, but also wanted to play all around the world. Regardless of the fact that you had people saying, no, you stay over here, those people stay over there, you know, we don't want them coming up from the South, you know, during the black migration, you know. But regardless of all that, the music still came here. The people of different groups still came to the music and loved the music and felt like it spoke to them and gave them freedom from the traditionalists and their approach to life in America. So jazz represented freedom away from that. You want to know that to give it context.
Now at the time, we had a movie that was produced in America called A Song Is Born. It was produced by Samuel Goldwyn. It's a story about how two professors are writing an encyclopedia of music and how they are made aware that there's a new genre called jazz. Now we're going to watch scenes from the movie, A Song Is Born. Now you're going to see this, you're going to see some very important jazz figures. You're going to see Benny Goodman, Louis Armstrong, Lionel Hampton, and others. And the interesting thing is that they, at the time, they were, musicians, regular musicians, you know, trying to get a good gig, and they got a good gig when they got this movie because it gave them even more exposure to their music. So that's important to know that these, you know, we look at them now as being pillars of jazz music, you know, world renowned, but at the time they were regular people eating, breathing, and playing. And you're going to see them in this movie in a very casual way. So here we go. This is A Song Is Born.
Thank you. get you some blues. From now on, that's all you'll be able to use. Do you hear me, Daddy-o? I'm gonna teach you some blues. However you wanted it, I sang your song. Whenever you wanted me, I tagged along. But that lipstick on your shirt isn't mine, so I'm getting off, it's the end of the line. Do you hear me, Daddy-o? I'm gonna teach you some blues.
He told you that a woman was his religion,
but I didn't hear him mention that he meant them all.
So now all your concern is just a dead pigeon.
Well, I've got to be the only filly in the stall.
You've got a lot of fish waiting round to nibble,
and your baby's got a line that they can overload.
So baby, oh, you're hardly in the mood to quibble.
He'll make me very happy if he'll hit the road. You gave me the runaround, and that was wrong. You wanted to run around, so run along. If we never meet again, it's too soon, and I'll make a bet you'll be changing your tune. Do you hear me, Daddy-o? I'm gonna teach you some blues. However you wanted it, I sang your song. Whenever you wanted me, I tagged along. But that lipstick on your shirt isn't mine, so I'm getting off, it's the end of the line. Do you hear me, Daddy-o? I'm gonna teach you some blues. I'll teach you. I'll teach you. Teach you, I'm gonna teach you some blues.
Okay, that was one clip, and now we're gonna look at another clip. You're gonna see some of these figures that I mentioned: Benny Goodman, Louis Armstrong, and Lionel Hampton. Here we go.
Gentlemen. We've accomplished a lot in the last 3 days, and we have many valuable records. Now, before we start on the history of jazz, someone mentioned yesterday a small combo doing jump with a head arrangement. I believe it was Mr.
Tommy Dorsey, Jimmy's brother.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. You spoke of...
It wasn't me, Professor. That's not my type.
It could have been Mel Powell or Hamp.
Yeah, they're experts at that jive.
Well, then perhaps you gentlemen could help me.
Oh, sure. Mel announced to play a lot of that stuff with Benny Goodman.
Oh, is that so? Well, could you play an example of the type of music?
Oh, we'd be glad to, but Joe, our clarinet, couldn't come.
Oh, that's too bad.
Can anyone here blow a clarinet?
Oh, that's quite simple. Our Professor Moggenbrook plays the clarinet.
Oh, you see, Professor, I hardly think he'd be able...
Oh, he happened to be a little too square.
He's quite proficient, I assure you. If you'll just get ready, I'll go and fetch him. Gentlemen, I don't wish to interrupt, but we seem to need a clarinet to illustrate a new form of music.
Well, I certainly do.
Oh, thank you very much. No, Moggenbrook, we need you with it.
You mean to play jazz?
Yes, it's very likely you might be able to play your umpadiddle.
Oh, then I'd better take my book along with me.
Good, then we'll all go along.
Yes, sure.
I think not, gentlemen. Perhaps you'd better continue with your work.
Oh, I wish we could go, too.
This is our Professor Moggenbrook, gentlemen.
Hello,
I see you have everything ready.
Is this the music here?
Oh, no, we don't use any music.
We haven't got anything written down, Professor.
Well, we can't play without music.
Well, Benny Goodman used to.
Benny Goodman? I never... First meet you ever hear of him?
No, I haven't. Perhaps there's something in this book that might help you, Mark.
Oh, yes.
Oh, just sit down, Professor, and if you feel like it, you can join in.
Thank you.
Mel, let's steal some apples. Professor, now anything we do, just follow us.
jamming on the one. So you get to see they were going in and really playing that music. And it had a very, what's interesting is that during this time, jazz had it was very palatable, that people who didn't know anything about jazz could sit down, listen to it, hear a good beat, and hear a certain type of swinging sound and instantly get into it. And that's interesting because many people feel like jazz has gotten away from that you have to be a deep thinker in order to get into jazz. But at the same time, the music needs to have that as well. But here, especially in this jazz, in this last scene, it was very communal type, entertaining type of music that they were presenting. So that's good to see, just regular people listening to the music and enjoying it. And also seeing how the performers were relating to the people that were listening to them. They were really endearing to them and they were really bringing them in and really trying to connect with them through the music. That is important as well. Of course, many years have evolved and some, you know, with evolution, you have different ways of presenting the music. Some people want to be entertainers. Some people don't want to be entertainers, that they want to just play the music and then you just hear the music. So there are different approaches, but I did want to point out that approach there in A Song Is Born. This concludes session 5. I want to thank you so much for listening. And students, make sure you take good notes. Very important, because there will be questions about what I am talking about on the exams. And I don't want you to say, I didn't know there was going to be, I didn't know you were going to talk about that, or I didn't know you were going to, you know, talk about this or whatever. What I try to do is I let you know when I'm saying something important. When I say this is important, make sure you're writing down what I'm saying and know those different ideas, because they will come back later in the tests, okay? So thank you very much, and we'll see you at session 6. All right, bye-bye.